and Will from Revelry Cycles coming to you on a beautiful sunny day in Sydney, Australia. Thank you so much for joining us. We're really glad that you're here. Today we're going to continue our conversation about everything high-performance Royal Enfield Twins with Big Boars. You'll probably find that our Big Boar conversation is actually a lot less complex than some of the other topics that we've addressed so far. It's a lot more mechanical or mathematical, I guess, and less magic than, say, tuning. Hmm. As always, we are going to put more information in the description of this video so that you can continue learning, and we'll just get into the basics and function of the S&S Big Boar kits.
In the camshaft episode, we talked a lot about increasing the engine's ability to breathe and moving more air fuel mixture through the engine to make more power. Well, same thing applies here. Today is all about giving the engine bigger lungs so it can breathe more. The big bore kits are all about increasing displacement. At the racetrack, there's an old saying, there is no replacement for displacement. So go big or go home.
The makeup of the S&S Big Boar kits is piston assemblies, head gasket, and cylinder liners. All right, so the job of the piston is to seal off the combustion chamber and provide a surface to transfer the force through the connecting rod and to the crankshaft. The parts of a piston are the crown. So the crown accepts all the force and pressure from the combustion chamber and all of the heat. It has a skirt. The skirt's job is to keep the piston true and straight in the cylinders. There is a pin boss. And then of course there's your rings. There are three ring grooves on the piston. The top ring is the compression ring. So the compression ring sits at the top there. It stops any combustion pressure from coming past the piston. It also helps to transfer the heat of the piston to the cylinder wall. The second ring is super cool. It's tapered. So on the way up, it acts as a backup compression ring. And then on the way down, it wipes the cylinder wall or scrapes the cylinder wall of oil and pushes it to the bottom. The bottom ring or rings, it's actually a three-piece ring. There are two hardened rings, and in the middle is this funny looking guy. This is an expander ring. The expander is basically a spring that pushes the two hardened ones against the cylinder wall to just push the oil down into the sump. The final piece of our piston assembly is the piston pin, also known as a wrist pin or a gudgeon pin. The job of this pin is to connect the piston to the connecting rod. Once the pin is installed in your piston, we just use these retaining clips at the ends, and this allows it to still move freely, but without coming out the end.
S&S currently has two kits available. There's a 750 kit and an 865. The standard piston is a 78 millimeter bore. The 750 kit is an 83.5 millimeter bore, and the 865 kit is a 90 millimeter bore. Big difference. The kits are just pistons, gaskets, and liners. The kit themselves, pretty simple. Installation, really not so simple. S&S says you need a qualified machinist and practical engine building experience. And even that is a little understated. This kit is definitely not bolt in. It starts with the original equipment cylinder has an outside diameter of the cylinder liners that is basically the same as the 865 piston itself. So you have to bore these completely out of the cylinder block and replace them with these liners. And you can see this 865 liner is nearly the same inside diameter as the original equipment liners were outside. So that machining operation is really very critical. You've got to achieve a very specific press fit of that liner into the cylinder. You've got to achieve a very closely specified depth so that you get the compression step in the right place. I don't have an 865 cylinder that I can show you because we put the last one we had in the building in this engine that we did this week. I do, however, have a 750 cylinder I can show you. This is a finished 750 cylinder with the liners in it, and you can see one of the things that is important to point out is not only do you have to get all those press fits of the liner right, but you have to get this surface flush when you press the liner in because there is a compression step built right in there to aid in holding that extra compression with the copper head gasket. So you can't, once you've machined these and pressed them in, you can't go back and surface this cylinder because you'll lose that compression step if you do. So the machining operation is really very critical for these and not to be taken lightly. And if you screw it up, it's an expensive mistake. Now, it also, assembling these takes a little bit of a different skill set as well, because now that these pistons are so much bigger, for example, none of the ring compressors work. The standard Royal Enfield ring compressor doesn't work. And you'll find that the nature of this 270 degree opposed twin, getting, when you've got one cylinder, one piston in the cylinder, getting the other one to go in the cylinder, you don't have room for commercially available piston ring compressors. So your super cheap auto piston ring compressor kit ain't gonna work. We've had to make our own piston ring compressors for the 865s, for example. And it's, you know, unless you're willing to do something at that level, this is not an install it at home kind of kit. If you don't have the right kind of ring compressor, trying to put these pistons in by compressing the rings with your fingers while you're holding this cylinder and, you know, not breaking some rings, not a real easy thing to do. So definitely, you know, not a home installation bolt-on kind of kit. The moral of the story is you really want somebody, you want a very qualified, competent, capable machinist machining these cylinders for you, and you want a very qualified, competent, capable engine builder doing the assembly for you. Now this bike, for example, we just did this week. This is the, it has the 865 kit, it's got an S&S cam, it's got our headers on it with S&S mufflers and a powertronic tuner and a S&S air cleaner. This is the first one of these 865s we've ever done that has a completely stock cylinder head and stock throttle bodies on it. All the other bikes we've done so far had CNC cylinder heads of one flavor or another and various different diameter throttle bodies. So I would like very much to get some horsepower numbers on this, but we're not going to be able to because this bike was shipped in to us from a customer in Queensland. We've finished the job, we've got the mapping all in it. I've ridden it about 100 kilometers just to get everything dialed in and right. And I can tell you, I don't know what it's gonna make for big power when you twist it up because it's only got 100 kilometers on it and we're still got a break-in map in it. But it does make really huge torque and it's great fun to ride. So if you'd like us to do something like that for you, we charge about 6 hours labor to do the basic 865 kit. All the pricing for all that stuff is on our website, but happy to do it for you. Just give us a ring. It's only got about 100 kilometers on it, so I'm not going to rev it real hard, but I will at least start it up, flip it, and let you hear. You can definitely hear the crispness of the bigger bore and the extra compression. So here we go. What can I reasonably expect from a big bore kit? Well, bigger bore will make more power and torque across the whole RPM range. One of the things that we know for sure is that certainly with the 865 kits, you have to have some sort of mechanism to control the fuel mixture. We tried running an 865 on the stock ECU, and under power and load, it's just too lean. Not safe, not a good thing. we know for a fact that a properly tuned 865 and all the ones that we have numbers on have some combination of CNC cylinder heads, bigger valve heads, throttle bodies, various diameters, and we're going to be getting into all that in subsequent videos. But a big bore kit with those modifications and all the stuff that we do on that you have to do. If you're going to do a big bore kit, you have to have mufflers, headers, air cleaner, tuner, cam, the whole bit. That setup with a bike with CNC heads and a throttle body will make, depending on how it's configured and the cams are timed, etc., between a 60 and 75% increase in horsepower over the average stock 650, and somewhere between 50 and 65% more torque. Now, that's a difference you can sure enough feel. These things, the big bore kits at that kind of horsepower and torque, are just fire breathing, tire smoking, wheelie popping little monsters, and they're huge fun to ride.
We wanted to take a minute and address some of the more common questions that we've been getting about doing big bores. So, first question, will doing a big bore affect the reliability of my engine?
We, especially based on how robust the Royal Enfield engine is and how, my term, over-engineered it is, I don't see any reason to expect anything but a long-term reliability out of these. This engine design is designed and manufactured to carry quite a bit more horsepower and torque than the original equipment 650 can possibly produce. So I'm really not concerned about long-term reliability of these engines at all. And we've been doing big bore engines, all kinds of different brands, for years. And hundreds of thousands of kilometers on them with no reliability issues. There's probably more reliability issue with customers than there is with the actual build of the engine.
Yeah. And we've been racing an 865 for a year. And I mean, that is nothing but hard work. Like, it is just wide open from start to finish. And we've had zero issues with that engine.
Yeah, I have no idea. We've countless passes, wide open throttle passes on that drag bike with no mechanical issues at all.
Touch wood, for sure. Yeah. All right. Now, what about heat? Is there going to be a heat issue? Do we need to upgrade our oil coolers?
Well, there are sort of two facets to the heat issue. One is the heat that the rider feels coming off the engine. And from experience, there really doesn't seem to be any difference that you can feel externally, the heat coming off the engine. And we do know that on the dyno, the cylinder head temperature from a stock bike to an 865 is basically the same. The other thing that certainly plays into engine heat is that the big bores tend to run at a richer mixture. Combustion chambers run cooler, so it's actually even possible that they might run cooler.
Absolutely. Adding nice cool fuel into that combustion chamber would definitely cool things off. So that sort of plays into the next question, is fuel consumption going to be an issue? Like, is it just going to be sucking fuel down?
I'm so glad you asked.
I know you are.
Because I've been tracking my fuel consumption.
Yes.
And I got my cheat sheet here. Royal Enfield claims that their in-city fuel consumption is 29 kilometers per liter. There are a couple of independent tests out there that say it's more like 2021. We've done some of our own longer term testing with stock bikes, and we're getting around 19 kilometers per liter. And if you ride a stock bike aggressively, it's closer to 18. Now, the 865 that I've been riding back and forth to work most days for quite a while now, it's got 4,000 or 5,000 kilometers on it now. Average in city only across all that time is 19.29. So the reality is my fuel consumption is basically riding there with a stock bike. Now, the other part of that is that I haven't yet had an opportunity to do any long-distance highway riding, and maybe somebody should give me a week off so I can go do a week-long, you know, highway fuel consumption test. But that notwithstanding, the other thing that plays into fuel consumption is the gearing of the vehicle. And the big bores make, especially the 865, makes so much more torque than a stock bike that you really don't want to run it at the stock gearing. stock bike has a 15 tooth front drive sprocket on it, and we universally recommend at least a 16 for the 865s. And if you're really riding it at high speeds, a 17, because it's got plenty of torque to pull it. The 16 just works incredibly well. It's a nice, smooth acceleration, lots of power, feels good, good for the clutch. And out on the highway, a 15-tooth sprocket runs one of these at about 4,000 RPM. A 16-tooth sprocket runs closer to 3,500 RPM. So a bigger motor that's more efficient, running at a lower RPM, might actually get better fuel mileage. And that's, we've experienced that with big bores before. It's possible to get better fuel mileage than a stock 650.
Yeah, again, because it's all about efficiency, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, so final question. Mm-hmm. If I convert my engine to a 750, can I later just bore it out to an 865?
All right. Yeah, no, you can't. The 750 and 865 kit liners are completely different. You see, this is a 750 liner, and the 865 piston is almost the outside diameter of that liner, so absolutely not. You can't.
There's not
two different
meat.
Sets of liners. Yeah. So you either choose a 750 or an 865. You don't put a 750 kit in, and then, well, you. All right.
You
could
do it, but you have to buy another kit
and do the whole operation all over
so
again. You
just
can't
machining.
Just bore the 750 right liner. Up. You can't just bore them out and put the 865 pistons in.
Cool beans.
Right on.
Thank you so much for joining us. We hope that you enjoyed our little chat here about big bores. We have built quite a few 865s now, but we haven't had a chance to do a 750. We have cylinders ready. If you would like a 750, please give us a call. We would love to build that engine for you. Next weekend, we're taking the weekend off. We are racing. We have sort of a test and tune and then a race the next day. It's a lot for us. Doing these videos, we love doing them. They're a great deal of work, and so we've decided it'd just be too much to try to fit it all in next weekend, so we're gonna have a little break. But in 2 weeks, you can expect our next video on cylinder heads.
Yeah, we will show you what's involved in our CNC big valve cylinder heads, show you some before and afters, give you some insight into the machining and what you can expect, and we're pretty excited about that. And we might as well preview that beyond that, the next one is going to be throttle bodies. So cylinder heads and throttle bodies coming up next.
Absolutely.
But after a week's break.
Yeah, we'll definitely be taking a week off. So until we see you again, remember,
you ain't having fun?
You're doing it wrong.